And if you would join me in Job chapter 32, and if you're a visitor, you don't have a Bible, there should be one in front of you, and you'll find Job 32 on page 438. Well, as we come back and return to our journey through the book of Job, as I told you, I think maybe a month ago, that we were starting the descend, a slow descend, but we are coming. There's a transition that occurs in this chapter we're in today, chapter 32. Clearly, a break happens. If you notice at the very last words of chapter 31, the scripture reads, "The words of Job are ended." Now, that is true in the context of his dialogue with his friends. They have reached a saturation point where they basically are saying, what's the use? We've tried and tried and tried to convince him. He is dug in his position. And so Eliphaz, Bildad, and Zophar, they are finished. And Job, equally so, the words of Job are ended. He has maintained the testimony. Little does he know what's really happening, because he doesn't get to read Job 1 and 2, that he has weathered the storm to date. However, a fourth character now enters into the scene, and his name is Elihu. I will need to mention, though, that Job does speak again later in the book. But it is in response to the Lord looking at him and saying, Job. And Job will be met not with defensiveness, but he will be met with the words of repentance, the words of awareness of who he truly is before God. But now we come to Elihu in chapter 32. And he will come and address the friends, and he will address Job. But he doesn't do so in dialogues. There's no dialogues that's occurring here. Elihu, for all practical purposes, we could say that he is preaching a sermon, multiple sermons. This is one-way communication. There's no exchange between the friends and Elihu, nor is there any exchange between Elihu and Job. And when we see the context of what he's going to contents of what he's going to say, then we will know why. Because Elihu comes, and though he speaks a lot of words, he speaks a lot of sound theology. He will cover the next six chapters. He addresses his friends in Job 32, and then five chapters towards Job himself. Well, what do we make of this man? Here's someone that's been silent for all this long period, listening to these dialogues, and now the young statesman speaks. What do we make of this man? Some scholars believe that the part that Elihu plays in Job's story is the most controversy in all the book. And that's for a couple reasons. There's two camps on this man. The first camp is that they group him in with his friends. They say that there's nothing new. Elihu comes and says the same thing that Eliphaz, Bildad, and Zophar says, so there's nothing added to this. I don't believe that that's the proper way to see Elihu. However, I would confess to you that that is the majority position. The majority of commentators and scholars would assume that Elihu is just an addition to the last three friends, and that he doesn't do anything for Job. I would argue that that's not correct. And that leads us to the other camp. The other camp is that they see Elihu coming in a completely different role in Job's life than his friends, and he's very positive. He's very positive. And you'll have to decide, and we can't be dogmatic about this, but I think the internal evidence of what we hear from Elihu would support the fact that he is a good guy, that he is a good guy. And I want to give you some evidence, not just my own opinion, but I want to give you some evidence. There was a Scottish theologian and pastor from the 17th century, well-known, well-respected. His name was James Durham. And Durham wrote a powerful book called The Lectures on Job. It's still available. And at the end of the Job series, I'm going to compile a bibliography of all these different books so that you'll have access in your own library if you want to do that. So we'll get to that to the end, whatever year that is. So, Durham says this, about Elihu and why he is a positive force. A positive force in Job's life. Number one, at the end of the book, God's anger is directed to Eliphaz, Bildad, and Zophar, but not Elihu. He never calls him out. Number two, Elihu speaks against Job, but he never labels him a hypocrite like his other friends. A third evidence that Elihu is a good friend, a really good friend, is that he does not accuse Job of his suffering due to sin. He never sees Job's suffering as sin. Another evidence that Elihu is on the positive side in Job's life is that he showed a lot of restraint and respect for the elder wisdom men of Eliphaz, Bildad, and Zophar. He didn't interrupt them. He just simply waited. And so there was some respect there. The fifth thing, and the major thing that we'll see after today, is that Elihu is absolutely committed to upholding God's justice and honor. He is a man of righteous anger, as we will see. The sixth evidence that Elihu is on the right side in Job's life is that he actually is pastoral to Job. He's not malicious to him. You imagine by now, as you sit here and listen to Eliphaz and Bildad and Zophar continue to give barrage after barrage of verbal abuse to Job, do you imagine the state he is right now? His heart is so wounded. He is so wounded by the verbal poison that has come upon him over just the beatdown over a long period of time. Eliphaz comes to him not malicious, not attacking, but pastoral. And one of the signs of him being pastoral is he's not afraid to speak hard truth of correction. The seventh thing that we find noting that Elihu may indeed be on the right side is that Job listens, and he listens not with a defensive posture. He doesn't listen like he did with Bildad, Zophar, and Eliphaz. As you saw throughout those speeches, it seems like Job just continues to boil inside. And as he goes through those speeches and he gets to the last cycle, he says a lot of very pointed things to Eliphaz, Bildad, in their last speeches. So as we look at Elihu today in the positive light and in the weeks to come, probably one or two more, is that we're going to learn something from them. We did learn from Eliphaz, hopefully, Eliphaz, Bildad, and Zophar. We learned how not to be a friend. We learned some very, very poor communication skills, so to speak, in regards to what those guys did to Job. Well, in Elihu, we can learn some very good things. And the underlying thing to take away from his life is that we are called to correct one another, and we are called to speak hard truth, but we need to do it with compassion. And we need to do it with real sensitivity. Now, one thing we do need to understand about Elihu, as much as I'm building up in here to be this positive spokesman into Job's life, is that he has strengths and weaknesses as well. He doesn't have the corner of truth. He doesn't know it all. And he doesn't come across as a know-it-all, though a surface reading, you may think so. And so we have to look at Elihu like we did the other characters. None of them got to read Job 1 and 2. None of them got to know what really is happening here, and that includes Elihu. So here's the roadmap, and you'll see it on your at least a couple of the points on our way through Elihu's life. Is number one, we're going to look at the man and his role in Job's story. We're going to look at his rebukes to Eliphaz, Zophar, and Bildad. Also Job, which is the predominant portion of his speeches. And then we want to tie all that together and say, okay, what do we learn from Elihu? What can we learn from him that would help us in our interpersonal relationships with one another, as well as in living out body life, as messed up as we are with one another? Let's start and look in 32 and verse 1 and 2. The first thing we need to look at is the man. Who is this man? Now, we don't have a lot of information, just like we don't have a lot of information on the friends. But what we do know may give us some indications of his godliness. So these three men ceased to answer Job because he was righteous in his own eyes. Then Elihu, the son of Barachel, The Buzite of the family of Ram burned with anger. He burned with anger at Job because he justified himself rather than God. Now, it's easy to read those first two verses, and because of the repetition, and that's always a good thing in your Bible, when you come across repetition in a very short period of time, pay great attention to that. And so we're going to find at least three times here, he's going to say burned with anger, burned with anger. So don't be quick to jump on that before you understand his lineage. Elihu. The name Elihu, it signifies whose God is he? And so he has some godly lineage that identified him as identifying with God. The next, this title there, the son of Barachel. Barachel, that word means God blesses. And so as we look at Elihu, don't skip what might look like preliminary to get into the juicy stuff of what he says, is that he may very well come from a very godly family similar to Job's. He may be from the same type of spirituality that Job's family was. He certainly has a father whose name means God blesses. And I don't want to stretch that too far, and we can't imply too much. But when we hear what Elihu says in defense of God's character, he had to get that from somewhere. And that shows at least the practicality that we as parents and in our marriages, we have a responsibility to be a passed down Christian. And when I say passed down Christian, is that you are responsible and I am responsible in on my generation to make sure that Christianity survives after I'm going. Now, I'm not saying it depends on us, but we certainly have been given the stewardship, and I'll talk about that tonight. We've been given the stewardship of the gospel in that we are responsible in our generation to pass it down. And here we have Elihu, who has some resemblance of godliness in his family. And what does he do? He's passing it down by way of correction in Job's life. Well, we gain something else about him. Let's go on and read more about his anger. Then Elihu, the son of Barachel, the Buzite of the family of Ram, burned with anger. He burned with anger at Job because he justified himself rather than God. He burned with anger also at Job's three friends because they had found no answer, although they had declared Job to be in the wrong. Now Elihu had waited to speak to Job because they were older than he. And when Elihu saw that there was no answer in the mouth of these three men, he burned with anger. Do you get the impression that Elihu is an angry person? I mean, how would you like to have that characteristic? Oh yeah, there's Jim. He burns with anger. And you want to know that? He burns with anger, and he burns with anger, and he burns with anger four times. Let's don't be quick to dismiss anger as always being sinful. Because anger is not always sinful. I would argue, and I'll start with myself, I would argue that I'm not an angry person, you know, by nature. You know, I know growing up, and it doesn't make me perfect by any means, but I remember growing up, my kids used to call me Gandhi, you know. Because I'm not an angry person. That doesn't mean I don't seethe within. But Elihu has this reputation of anger. But let's note here that his anger is just. And we must make a distinction, because I would say that most of our outburst of anger, it's not righteous anger. Most of the anger that we vent on a child or vent on a spouse or vent to another Christian, most of the impulsiveness in our lives that causes us to unleash anger, most of it is not righteous anger. Because if it's righteous anger, it's going to be bathed in humility. And it's going to be bathed with the goal of God's honor. And that's exactly what Elihu is going to do. Now, there's a distinction, and I want to just stress this home for a minute. The distinction between sinful and righteous anger. Sinful and righteous anger. And I want to serve as a warning for us, too. Few things will do severe damage to your testimony for Jesus Christ than an uncontrolled tongue that vents in anger. Few things will do more damage to your testimony for Jesus Christ than an uncontrolled tongue that produces anger. Now, yes, you can recover with that, but the damage can be very severe. You remember the old World War II saying, loose lips sink ships? I like that. I want one of those posters. Loose lips sink ships. You know what? Loose lips sink lives too. And so be very careful. Be very careful. The Apostle Paul would make a distinction between justified anger and sinful anger. He would say in Ephesians chapter 4, verse 26, be angry and do not sin. So there is a clear line of demarcation. Be angry and do not sin. That is an anger. We should be angry over the sins of our nation, not because of what it does to us, because of the offense it is to a holy God. We should be over the top angry, not at the people committing these sins, but we should be angry at the control of Satan and the way this world is going down the tubes and our nation dying. We should be angry because God's honor is being spewed upon. And this is Elihu. He has a righteous anger, which we will see. And so Paul says, be angry and do not sin. And then he says in verse 31 of Ephesians 4, let all bitterness and wrath and anger be put away from you. Friends, that's no contradiction. It's all about the object. You know when you know what anger really is in its purest, you know what anger is? It's a venting of your selfishness because things and people aren't going the way you want them to. That's what anger is. Anger is a venting because your will is not being done, and that people and circumstances are not conforming to what you want. And every one of you could say amen, because it's true. Ouch. And ouch would fit well. And that's traced back to the Garden of Eden. Well, as you move on to Elihu and you hear his speeches, this is what you're going to find in his speeches. You're going to find passion. He's burning with righteous anger. You're also going to find eloquence. And we're going to read some of his speeches in advance to drive home the points of today, and then we'll go back. I want you to be so encouraged by what we're going to hear from Elihu, because he provides sound theology that should fuel worship. And one of the things that Job struggles from is that he is so wrapped up in his pain and so wrapped up in himself that he has lost sight of the sovereignty of God in his life that should produce worship. Well, Elihu is going to paint some beautiful pictures of the majesty of God in his speeches, which should take us out of our small kingdom of self and move us into the larger, majestic kingdom of our God. So we're going to find passion in his speeches. We're going to find eloquence. We're also going to find warmth. There's devotion in his speeches. We will not find him attacking Job's person. Now, he will attack Job's conduct, and he will attack Job's assumptions that he made and assessments he made of God, but he won't attack his person. And we're also going to find some true orthodoxy in his speeches. Orthodoxy that points to what humanity is truly like, and also the majestic character of our God. Now, as much as I painted this wonderful picture of Elihu, and believe me, he's not John the Baptist. I mean, he's not. He's not saved from the womb. You know, this man has issues, like all of us do. But what we don't find in Elihu, which we did find in Eliphaz, Bildad, and Zophar, is we don't find hypocrisy. We find sincerity. Not perfection, but we find sincerity. And one of the flaws that he may has, go down to verse 17 of chapter 32. This may be a flaw, and I'm going to say maybe, but I should say it will be, because Solomon tells us that this is always true. Eliphaz is so bent on honoring God's honor, his respect for who he is, and his desire to correct the false theology of Job as well as his friends, is that he has a lot to say and he just can't keep it in. Solomon tells us this, Proverbs 10:19, when words are many, transgression is not lacking, but whoever restrains his lips is prudent. Just like anger has a balance, there's a sinful anger and there's a righteous anger, so does our speech. We at times can speak too much, And Solomon says, when we speak too much, sin's not lacking. So if you want to cut your tongue out now, you may. Is it? But on the other side, that there's a time that we have to speak much. Well, take a look at verse 17, Job 32, 17. Elihu says, I also will answer with my share, and his share is a lot. I also will declare my opinion, and his opinion is going to be laced in truth. Be very careful in the use of your tongue. There's a lot going on in our world today that can draw you into some serious debates, whether it be social media, whether it be among unsaved friends, whether it even be among Christians. You got to be very careful in regards to that. Careful in this sense. Do not allow the compulsion that you may have to voice an opinion always to be voiced. Our opinions really don't matter. And so it's important that Solomon says that a fool only desires to vent himself. But he who is wise restrains his lips. I'm not saying don't speak into the issues of the land, and we need to do that. But let's be very careful that the what we speak into the land is thus saith the Lord and not thus saith Jim. Well, let's take a look what he says. I also will answer my share. I also will declare my opinion. Verse 18, for I am full of words. The spirit within me constrains me. Now, he's alluding to the fact is that he is under God's control in what he's speaking. Now, we know this is before the permanent indwelling of the Spirit. But remember in Old Testament times that the Spirit of God came upon people and used people and gifted people. He just didn't indwell them permanently. Let's go on. Behold, my belly is like wine that has no vent, like new wineskins ready to burst. I must speak that I may find relief. I must open my lips and answer. When I read that, I chuckled. I'm thinking Elihu is he's sitting there listening to all this nonsense from Eliphaz, Bildad, and Zophar. And then Job's trying to defend himself, and he's saying things he shouldn't. And you can just sense this younger guy. He's swelling up inside. And he says, I have got to say something. I have got to voice my opinion. And in this case, when Elihu speaks, he's right. This is a time when he says, I am full of words. What he speaks is true. And there are times that we need to be full of words as well. Just like when I said earlier. But let's make sure it's full of words like we read in Jeremiah. Where Jeremiah says, I cannot mention him. I will not speak any more of him. But there's in my heart a burning fire shut up in my bones. I cannot help. I must speak of him. And what about the early church? Aren't you so glad the early church didn't just say, we're just going to live the Christian life and that's my witness. It says the early church went everywhere preaching the gospel. The disciples anchored down in Jerusalem, and the church is under persecution, and they went everywhere preaching the gospel. I'll mention that tonight in the Thessalonican church. I'll get it right tonight. Is that when you see that church, because of the power of the gospel, they had to tell people. In the early church, in the book of Acts, we find that the persecution comes upon the disciples. They bring them together, and they told them, no more. No more talking about Jesus. No more talking about the resurrection. And this is what Peter and John said. Whether it is right in the sight of God to listen to you rather than God, you must judge. But we cannot but speak of what we have seen and heard. One of the glaring problems or deficiencies, in my opinion, in the Church of Jesus Christ today is that we have been too silent in the culture. Silent not in a sense of activism, but silence in the context of proclaiming the only message that will change this world, and that is the gospel of Jesus Christ. We have been too silent. Elihu is going to speak a lot, and in this case, the man is right. Let's move on. Go back to verse 2 of 32. What is the role that Elihu will play? What is the role of this man? Well, we see that he likely was a godly man. He was a man displaying righteous anger. And this is the three things that he wants to do, or he's called to do in the story of Job. Verse 2 again, then Elihu, the son of Barachel, the Buzite of the family of Ram, burned with anger. He burned with anger at Job because he justified himself rather than God. Number one, Elihu's role is to correct Job's view of God. To correct Job's view of God. Now picture this man. This is a younger man. He has respect for the wisdom men of the age. And he's restrained himself for a long time. You must understand that he has a sense of timidity. He will say later on that I tremble. Because he's speaking to one of the men that had a great reputation in the town. He's going to speak and correct an older man. A man who had a reputation of being what? Blameless, feared God, eschewed evil. And so Elihu has a proper understanding that what he's about to do isn't easy. But he's going to correct Job's view of God. And the tension that lies within Elihu in doing this is because he's listened to Job throughout the book, throughout the dialogues. And Job has repeatedly justified or defended himself. He's defended his innocency. He's defended that what Eliphaz, Bildad, and Zophar are saying, why he's suffering, he's defending himself, say it's not true, and he's towed the line. And Job has been right. Elihu is not correcting Job for defending himself among his friends. Elihu is going to correct Job because he's crossed the line in his accusations against God. Now, God, in his mercy and in his grace, he doesn't say that Job sinned. But if we go back and we look at the various things that Job said about God, aren't you glad that he is such a patient, kind, loving, and merciful God? How many times have you been in a tough circumstance and it looks like there's no way out and it looks like there is absolutely nothing good that can come out of this and you've had a temptation to complain to God? That you've had the temptation to be a little bitter towards God. Or perhaps you've been disrespectful. You wouldn't cross a line and call out like Job did, but you've had this spirit of rebellion because you don't like what you're going through. And you don't like the circumstances in your life. Well, Job let it go. In fact, if you remember the various why questions that Job presents to God shows just how wrong he was. Job chapter 7, verse 20. If I sin, what do I do to you, watcher of mankind? Why have you made me your mark? Why have I become a burden to you? Really? Is God a burden? Are we a burden to God? As his children, you know what we are? Beloved. We're beloved. We're chosen. We're predestined to be conformed to the image of Christ. Aren't you glad that God doesn't see you as a burden? And Job says to God, why? Why have I become a burden to you? He never did. Well, Job 13, we have another example of Job being disrespectful in his responses to God. Why do you hide your face and count me as your enemy? Wait a minute. Outside the gospel of Jesus Christ, we are enemies. In Christ, there's no hostility. The hostility is removed forever. And yet Job in his pain. And again, I just want to stress to you is how good is God? How great and wonderful is the mercy of God that he doesn't come down on Job and said, stop it. You are blaspheming me. You are forgetting all the goodness that I've displayed in your life. And above all else, Job, I'm the potter and you're the clay. What right does the clay have to speak back to the potter? And yet, God doesn't do that. And those times when you've been downcast and you've been in a trial or a situation that you think is never going to end, and you've been tempted to cry out to God in ways that are disrespectful, he's not going to cast you away. And this is what Elihu will do. He's going to correct Job's view of God. Well, there's a second role that Eliphaz will play in the story of Job, and this is the primary one. It's also in verse 2 implied. Then Elihu, the son of Barachel, the Buzite of the family of Ram, burned with anger. He burned with anger Job because he justified himself rather than God. If you notice that in the mission statement of Elihu, this isn't primarily about Job. Remember, he's out to defend God. And I know God doesn't need defended. But what God does need from us, and I say that need not in a sense that he is dependent on us, but what God does entrust for us people is to not just defend his character, but to proclaim his character. There's a lot of stuff in the Church of Jesus Christ out there that I would argue is missing the centrality of theology, of doctrine, of who God is. You don't go to church to feel good, and you don't go to church to be entertained, and you don't go to church just to hear a motivational speak. You go to church to meet God. And you meet him through the Word, the expounded Word, that points us to the majesty of his person. Now, if you only love God and only serve God for what he does to you, what's going to happen when you're in a Job-like situation? If you only want to follow Christ because of the benefits of heaven, and by the way, heaven is an add-on, really. Do you know what the greatest thing about being a Christian is? Is you get to spend eternity with the living God. You get to know the living God. You get to love the living God. You get to cherish and worship the living God. That's what it means to be a Christian. It's not escaping the wrath of God primarily. It's about being reconciled to him so that you can know him, that you can experience him. And Elihu's primary role here in verse 2 is not to justify, is to correct Job, but it is to justify God. Christopher Ashe has said this, quote, Elihu is right to be hotly indignant on the behalf of the name and reputation of the good and just God of all the earth when he is accused of injustice by a human being, end quote. The audacity of a human being to look up to God and say, unfair. Well, the first thing, look at verse 10. There are three eloquent examples of Elihu's defense of God's character. First is his righteous justice. Verse 10, therefore hear me, you men of understanding, far be it from God. Those are important. Pay attention to those type of phrases in your Bible. Far be it. Far be it from God that he should do wickedness, and from the Almighty that he should do wrong. We go down to verse 12. Of a truth, God will not do wickedly, and the Almighty will not pervert justice. The phrase, far be it, is extremely strong. Elihu is saying it is a reprehensible thing that God should ever do wickedness. It is so illogical, and it's such a contradiction, that the holy, righteous God would ever do anything that is unjust. That's what he's telling Job. Now, how does that apply to us? There's a similar language in Romans chapter 6, where the Apostle Paul would say, what shall we say then? Are we to continue in sin that grace may abound? And then he says, by no means. Or he could have said, far be it. How can you who claim to know Christ and you who claim to be born again and claim to walk with him, how can you live in sin? It's irreprehensible to think that a Christian would tolerate sin. And Elihu is saying, it's irreprehensible, Job, that you would say that God is unjust. If God is unjust, he needs to change his name and change his character. There was a story of a young soldier. He was in the army of Alexander the Great, one of the great military leaders of all time. This soldier was constantly in trouble. His performance was always marginal at best. Well, as we would, if this was today in the Navy, we would say that this young soldier Seder is going to captain's mass because he now is summoned before Alexander the Great. And he's being quizzed over his conduct with due punishment to follow. As this young soldier named Alexander stands before Alexander the Great, the military general says one thing right out of the gate. What is your name? And the soldiers smile and say, well, sir, it's the same as yours. My name is Alexander. And the military looked at him and says, soldier, change your conduct or change your name. God would have to change his name and change his character if he changed his conduct. He will not compromise his justice, his righteous justice. And for us as Christians, let's tie it into the story as well as to this. What? Far be it from me that I should live in sin. Christian, you bear the name Christ. You identify when you said, I believe, and you identify with Jesus Christ, you have just established the responsibility and the privilege to represent him well. To represent him well in your home, represent him well on your job, represent him well in church, represent him well in your neighborhood. One of the things that the world deserves, and I know that they're under the wrath of God. You know what the world deserves from us who claim the name of Christ? An accurate portrait of who he is. The worst testimony for the church of Jesus Christ is the church of Jesus Christ. And I'm not saying we're going to be perfect, but we can be authentic. And the world, as I've harped on for weeks, and I will, is the world needs to see the authenticity of Christians. Elihu is going to say to Job, listen, you're not just at all. There's only one who's just, and it's not you. Well, let's move on. There's something else that we can see in his defense. Look at chapter 36. We see now his glorious, as I labeled this, impartiality. Verse 5, behold, God is mighty and does not despise any. He is mighty in strength of understanding. He does not keep the wicked alive, but gives the afflicted their right. He does not withdraw his eyes from the righteous, but with kings on the throne, he sets them forever, and they are exalted. This is poetic language. And what Elihu is saying to Job is that God is impartial in his dealing with people. The wicked will get their due just, and the righteous will get their due just as well. This sounds a lot like Abraham. When Abraham says, far be it from you, shall not the judge of all the earth do what is just? And so Elihu, in wonderful language, he is going to correct Job's view of God in his righteousness, his justice. He's going to correct him in his showing his impartiality. And then finally, look at chapter 37, verse 1. Elihu is going to correct Job and, as fallout, his friends in the character of God and his power. Job 37, verse 1, Elihu, waxing eloquent in the theology of the power of God's word. At this also my heart trembles. Do you see the tie-in with the call to worship? Isaiah says the Lord will look upon those who tremble at his word. Elihu says, my heart trembles. He has a proper understanding of what it means. You're not going to rush into the presence of God as some cosmic buddy. You don't see God as a grandfather, an old grandfather in the heaven granting your every wishes. This is the holy, holy, holy God who even Elihu trembles. This also, my heart trembles and leaps out of his place. Keep listening to the thunder of his voice. Now, notice how many times Elihu is going to refer to God's voice, God's mouth, which implies God's word. Thunder of his voice and the trembling, rumbling that comes from his mouth. Under the whole heaven, he lets it go and is lightning to the corners of the earth. After it, his voice roars. He thunders with his majestic voice, and he does not restrain the lightnings when his voice is heard. God thunders wondrously with his voice. He does great things that we cannot comprehend. For to the snow he says, fall on the earth. Likewise to the downpour, his mighty downpour. He seals up the hand of every man that all men whom he made may know it. What do you see there? You see sovereignty. You see authority. You see beauty. The Psalms are a great place to see this as well. I was going to read Psalm 29, but I won't. Go ahead and read Psalm 29 sometime, and you're going to hear, again, the repeated voice, 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 voice. Everything that God does in His world and in the lives of His people is through His Word. That's why we unashamedly in our church, we're committed to a high view of the Bible. We're not going to compromise at what the Bible says we do. And if we're doing something that the Bible doesn't support, or if we can do it and take the Bible away, then we just won't do it anymore. We're not doing that. We're a people of the Bible. Well, Elihu is going to remind them of the majestic sovereign power of God, and in particular, His thundering voice. And then verse 11 and 12 of Job 32, go back, and this is the last point of the day. Here's the third reason. Here's the third reason why Elihu is brought into the scene. He's brought in to correct Job's view of God. He's brought into the defense of God's character for all the hearers. And the third reason is his correction of not only Job, but Eliphaz, Bildad, and Zophar. I drove a lot of miles in the last week. Job 32:3, he burned with anger also at Job's three friends. Why was he angry at them? Because they found no answer, although they had declared Job to be in the wrong. How cruel is that? Elihu is saying, you have been so mean. You accuse Job of this. You accuse Job of this. You say he's this and this, but you don't provide him any comfort. You don't provide him any help. All you do is slam the guy all through his pain. He says, behold, I waited for your words. I listened for your wise sayings while you searched out what to say. I gave you my attention. And behold, there was none among you who refuted Job or answered his words. You know what these guys are? Is exactly what Job said they were. And Elihu is implying that these were worthless physicians. Friends that want to diagnose what's wrong to you, even at a distance, but never once come alongside to help you. They want to quickly find what's wrong in your life, but they've never entered into your life. And Elihu is correcting them. He's saying, your counsel has been worthless, and I'm about to speak truth of who God is. I think what's interesting about this, though, is that Elihu, he doesn't target his correction. He's impartial. Why? Because at the center of his objective is God's honor. And if you're partial in how you deal with people, you're really not living for God's honor. I mean, if you're partial, you know, like if you want to be critical of someone's sin or be quick to look for blemishes in their life, it's probably the people you don't like very well anyway. It's probably people that you're not very close to anyway. Elihu is willing to be impartial in his corrections. He doesn't target Job. He targets all of them. That's a lesson of impartiality in dealing with one another. Friends, don't be quick to jump in someone's life and correct them without first getting into their life. Don't stand at a distance like the Levite and like the priest looking at the beaten, hurt man in Luke 10. Don't walk by in a pious, well, I got a schedule to keep. Be the good Samaritan. And before you can heal someone, you got to know someone. Elihu is really giving some sound advice to these guys by way of correction. Well, and that moves into the second part of this three-part look at Elihu, and that is his rebukes. His rebukes. And we'll look at that next week. We already touched on that a little bit with the Eliphaz and Zophar and Bildad. We'll go back to that next week. So for today, we've met the man Elihu. There's a wealth of examples from him. Be a person of conviction. Know the difference between righteous anger and unrighteous anger. Know when to speak, how to speak, what to speak. And make sure it's more the words of Christ and his gospel than your opinion. And Elihu is going to expose us to some majestic pictures of the character of our God. Let's pray. Father, we thank you so much for your great love and for your word and how true you are to your word. And may you help us remember these things. May you help us to apply these to our things and see that in Elihu there's much good. May we be more like him in dealing with people and even when we're called to correct one another. And we thank you in Christ's name. Amen.